Good morning, Pleasant View. What a blessing it is to be in church, where we can be encouraged by the wonderful community that we have here. We can be strengthened through the expounding of the word. We can maybe meet somebody new, and where we can worship Jesus as a body, and that's what we're going to do to start out. So let's stand and join our voices as we lift up our Lord.
Thank you.
Before we continue our worship, we'd love for you to take a moment to say hello to someone that's standing or sitting near you. As we continue our time of worship, I'd like to read some verses from Hebrews 13. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Do not be led away by diverse and strange teachings, for it is good for the heart to be strengthened by grace, not by foods which have not benefited those devoted to them. Through Jesus Christ, then, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God, that is, the fruit of lips that acknowledge his name.
see on the hill of Calvary, my Savior bled for me, my Jesus set me free. Look at the wounds that give me life, grace flowing from His side, no greater sacrifice.
For worshiping with us. You may be seated. And while you are doing so, we're going to dismiss kids aged kindergarten through third grade out the back door for class designed for them. So thank you so much, kids, for being here. We're grateful for those who are going to catch them on the backside there. My name is Jason. I'm one of the pastors here. It's my privilege to welcome you to Pleasant View. If this is your first time or first couple of times here, we hope you've already been made to feel welcome. We just had a great experience at Next Steps at the 9 a.m. hour for those who are new-ish to the church, to meet some of the people who are not, and to connect and learn more about the church, and we can learn more about you. We do have a connect card in the table seat back in front of you, and if you are new-ish here, we'd love to have you grab one of those and fill it out. You can take it to either of the kiosks in the lobby. We'd love to meet you officially and hear your story. We have a gift for you as well, and so thank you very much for being here. I'd like to update you on how the parking lot is doing. We are raising money for a parking lot renovation, and we are at $160,000, 51% of the way there, and that project will be starting in August. And so we're grateful. Thank you so much for those of you who have given to that project. We ask that you would continue to prayerfully consider what you might contribute as we work on raising the rest of the funds to take care of what God has entrusted to us physically here at the campus. Also want to continue to remind you to sign your kids up for VBS. If you have not yet signed up your kids for VBS, we're getting really close to that. This Sunday and the next Sunday will be the last day to sign up kids for VBS. So if you have not yet, if you've been delaying for some reason, please sign up your children before next Sunday. We'll be cutting off the registrations at that point. Last thing, we have been we've been working on how we might do a better job at visiting those people in our congregation who can't be here on a Sunday morning or who might be in the hospital or sick. And it is something that we know we can do better at as a church. And so we're very excited. I wanted to let you know that we are starting to put together a formal visitation team and visitation ministry. If you have time during the week, you have time that is at your discretion that you might be able to go and visit folks. And if you have the gift of gab and hospitality and you would like to just sit and talk with people and comfort them, and you would like to, you know, participate in that, please let the office know. We're building a team of people who will be used for that. And then there is already a opportunity in the app for you to let the church know that you or somebody in the congregation that you're aware of could benefit from a visit. So in the app, if you scroll down to the ministries slide and then you go over a few tiles, you'll see a picture that looks just like that. And you can click there and that will give you an opportunity to let the office know, hey, Bob needs a visit or something like that. And then obviously you can still email or call the office and use the old tech way as well. But it is in the app as well. You can let us know that that is something that you think needs to be done. And we are working on getting better at doing that. At this time, we're going to have a missions moment. So we're going to invite Elizabeth Barge to come on up and share with us what the Lord has been doing through her.
Hi. For those of you who don't know me, my name's Elizabeth Barge. I attended Grace College for elementary education and then graduated in 2013. I started teaching at Eisenhower Elementary, and during that time, I also started attending Pleasant View. But in 2018, I moved to Romania to work as a missionary with an organization called Teach Beyond. They work mostly with teachers and international Christian schools. So Romania is a country in Eastern Europe with a history of communism. This history led to an orphan crisis in the 90s, and some of those effects of that time can still be seen in the country today. Most people in Romania are Romanian Orthodox, but religion is more of a tradition for them than something that affects their daily lives. And only about 6% of the population is evangelical Christian. So I work at a Baptist children's home in rural Romania. The home was first opened by the local Baptist churches in 1926, but then the communist government shut it down for a while. And when the churches got the land back, they reopened in 1996. And since then, many kids have called Casa Dorca home. Because it's a Baptist orphanage or a Baptist children's home, all of the staff are believers, and they are also all Romanian, except for myself and one other American volunteer. We serve boys and girls so that sibling groups can stay together, and currently we have children between the ages of 12 and 21, and we have 11 kids who are living there right now. Although it's called an orphanage, it's none of the children are really true orphans. They all still have at least one parent living, but they've been removed from their homes by Child Protective Services because of a lack of resources or there was abuse in the home. The kids all attend local schools. And because of my background in elementary education, I have taken on a big role in their education. So I work mostly with the middle schoolers who were in elementary school when I started. And when they come back from school, I help them with their homework. We do extra tutoring if needed. And I also teach English classes to all the children. However, my role is varied, and sometimes my day might include crafts, lessons about different career opportunities the kids could have in the future, internet safety, lessons about human trafficking, and other subjects along those lines. And then there are some fun recreational things that I've also gotten to do with the kids, taking them on outings, driving them to appointments in the city, and then trying to help them just experience the beauty and culture of their country. In the past, part of my role has been to lead Bible studies with the children. Because it's a Baptist home, all of the kids do attend church on Sundays, but that doesn't mean that they're necessarily interested in God or the Bible. And so the studies I've led in the past have been poorly attended and with little engagement. But I have a fun and encouraging story to share with you related to that. Recently, the youngest child at Casa Dorca, her name's Ramona, she's on the left, she came to me and she said, "Ellie, I really want to do a study with the kids about our value in God's eyes, how he thinks we're all valuable, whether we're rich or poor, and I want to talk to the other kids about this, and we can have snacks." And so I told her it was a great idea, and so she invited all of the kids to attend. She bought snacks for our meeting with her pocket money, and then sat down with me to figure out what she wanted to say for her lesson. And she wrote down what she wanted to say. We found some Bible verses to share with the kids. And I was amazed by the attendance and the engagement that I saw at that meeting. Almost all of the kids came. They were answering questions, and they were asking questions of their own about the passages we read. And at the end of this our time, one of the other girls suggested that we continue this every week. So for the 2 months before I came back to America to visit, each of the kids was taking a turn planning a lesson, whether by themselves or with me, and then sharing it with the other children. So honestly, I was just so encouraged by how the Holy Spirit worked through Ramona to bring this about. So please pray for the children that these Bible studies will continue even while I'm not there. And that their interest in God's word will continue to grow. And pray especially for Ramona, that she would continue to develop a personal relationship with Jesus. As far as prayer requests for myself, I am heading back to Romania in July, but I will be on a sabbatical until the middle of November. So please pray that this time will be a refreshing and restful time with the Lord, and that I will feel renewed to enter back into ministry in November. So if you'd like a prayer card from me, please stop me after the service, or if you're interested in getting my newsletter, you could email me at ebarge@teachbeyond.org. So I just wanted to say thank you so much for your prayers and support for me and other missionaries who are serving. It's only because of churches and people like you that I can do the work that I'm doing right now. So thank you very much.
It's awesome to see how the Lord is using Pleasant View around the world. So now we're going to have Pastor Tyler come up and lead us in pastoral prayer. And so this is the first time we get to introduce him as that officially to you. So here he is, Pastor Tyler, to lead us in prayer.
Zero pressure. So last night we were reading a passage with our kiddos in Ephesians that I thought just really fit well with what we've been learning in Acts, and so I just wanted to read that, and then we can pray. So this is from Paul to the Ephesians, and he says, "For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles," which just is staggering that Paul, this Pharisee, would be preaching on behalf of Gentiles. And so just we being those Gentiles. "Assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. And I just thought, what good news it is that we, as those Gentiles, generations and generations later, get to hear about Christ and follow Christ and be a part of the same body. So with that in mind, let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity that not only do we get to be a part of your body, the church, but we also get to meet publicly in a place where we can talk about you openly and not be afraid of it. Lord, we think of our missionaries across the world who are in very different circumstances, and we pray that you would encourage them and lift them up, speak to them and comfort them, let them know that they are not alone, that we are part of the body alongside of them. Lord, we thank you that we get to gather together and hear from your word. We pray that you would soften our hearts, humble us, and help us to remember that each of us has something to learn. And I pray that you would teach us this morning as we open our hearts to you, that you would show us something in our own lives that needs to be changed and made more like you, that you would put us in the path of people who don't know you, that we would have the opportunity to share your love with them and draw them into this opportunity that we share of being a part of your body. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We live in a time where we have more voices, more people telling us how we should live or how we should think than maybe any time in history. We've got books and authors that we read. We have things on the television. We've got YouTube videos and podcasts. We've got doctors and medical professionals telling us how we should eat and how we should live from day to day. We've got social media pages with people that comment on things and tell us how we should think or that they don't agree with that, or other people's threads coming through that are promoting this or that idea. And I mean, everywhere we look, there are voices telling us how to think, how to reason, how to live, how to act. Some of those voices are subtle and others are screaming at us. And so, when you process all of these different opinions and voices, what holds the final authority in your life? When you're presented, particularly with maybe a new idea or a new proposition or something that you hadn't considered much before, how do you process that, and by what standard do you determine whether it's true or to what degree it's true? When you hear about churches that are doing something different, something novel, something unique, on what basis do you determine whether that's a legitimate or an illegitimate form of ministry or practice? Now, I would guess that most of you here this morning, as if you're a Christian and you're attending at least this morning a Bible church, you've probably got the answer right, or at least significant part of that answer right, and that is the scriptures, or the Bible should be that which is our final authority. That should judge the propositions or the ideas that we think. That should judge whether or not a ministry is legitimate or illegitimate in how it is going about. And yet, unfortunately, even for those of us who get the answer right, we know the right answer to that question. The truth is, oftentimes, there are a lot of other factors at play that ultimately, when push comes to shove, become the real thing that causes us to make up our mind in one direction or another. And this is really evidenced, I believe, in the passage we're going to see this morning in Acts chapter 17. In fact, Acts chapter 17 is going to provide us with two different cities. Both of them had the voice of Paul, Silas, and his ministry team speaking into their lives. Both cities had something new being presented to them. And one of them responds in one way, and the other responds in a way that the scriptures say were more noble, the more noble way. And their way is essentially to test it against the scripture. And so this morning, I just want us to look at these contrasting examples, and then just to think practically, or what are some ways that we oftentimes confuse what it looks like to wrestle with scripture and allow scripture to be our guide as opposed to some false substitutes for that. So, if you haven't already turned in the scriptures to Acts chapter 17, that's where we find ourselves this morning. Acts chapter 17, I'm going to begin reading in verse 1. It says, "Now, when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, and they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews, and Paul went in as was his custom. And on three Sabbath days, he reasoned with them from the scriptures." So Paul's going into the synagogue on the Sabbath. This was his practice, as we've already discovered. In every new city that he went, essentially, the way that he got an inroad with the gospel to ears of people who had an interest in these things is he would seek out the synagogue, he would go there, and he would begin to speak. And he would reason from their Jewish Old Testament scriptures for Jesus being the Messiah. And so this is what he's doing for three straight Sabbaths. He's reasoning, he's explaining to them how those scriptures point to Jesus as the Messiah and as one who had to suffer and rise from the dead, it says there. Let me just start again in verse 3. "Explaining and proving that it was necessary for the Christ, the Messiah, to suffer and to rise from the dead. And saying, this Jesus whom I proclaim to you is the Christ," is the Messiah. "And some of them were persuaded. And they joined Paul and Silas, as did a great many of the devout Greeks," or Gentiles, "and not a few of the leading women." This not a few is kind of just another way of saying a whole bunch of the leading women. And I think we can see, you glance down to verse 12, you're going to have parallel statements made about the church in Thessalonica. And there we're told that the leading women were Greek women or Jewish or Gentile women. And so what we see here is that a whole bunch of Gentiles respond and some of the Jews respond. Verse 5, "But the Jews were jealous, and taking some wicked men of the rabble, they formed a mob, set the city in an uproar, and attacked the house of Jason, seeking to bring them out to the crowd. And when they could not find them, they dragged Jason and some of the brothers before the city authorities, shouting, 'These men who have turned the world upside down have come here also,'" referring to Paul and Silas. "And Jason has received them, and they are all acting against the decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king, Jesus. And the people and the city authorities were disturbed when they heard these things. And when they had taken money as security from Jason and the rest, they let them go." So we see here the example of the church in Thessalonica, the Jews in Thessalonica. And there's actually a lot of parallels between Acts 17, 1 through 9, and Acts 13. If you remember, there was a church there where, not a church, a synagogue where Paul came and he spoke for several days. Initially, there was a great reception from many of the Jews, as well as the God-fearing Gentiles who attended that. And then on one day, a whole bunch of Gentiles came back out to hear these amazing words that Paul, in that context, Barnabas, were teaching. Namely, how the gospel had opened things up to Gentiles to receive salvation, and they didn't have to become Jews to do it. And the Jews there, in large part, became jealous. They became jealous of all of these Gentiles coming in. And so they rejected the word, the gospel that Paul preached, whereas many of the Gentiles embraced and accepted it. And so if you just, if you're taking some time to read through this later this week at all, go back to Acts 13 and look, because Paul lays out essentially the same message here. You know, we talk about one-hit wonders, preachers who have, you know, one good sermon that they preach and they do it well. I imagine Paul had more than one, but I get the sense as you read through here that his message in each of these synagogues was essentially the same thing. He had essentially the same message. He probably went to essentially the same scriptures in the Old Testament to make the case that Jesus was the Messiah. Look, he had to suffer. It was predicted. Look, he was predicted to rise again, and this is what Jesus did. And so back in Acts 13, it lays out what many of those scriptures were that he went to. Here it just says he explained from the scriptures. And in verse 4, as I already pointed out, it says some of them, some of the Jews from the synagogue, were persuaded to join Paul and Silas. But then it says that a great many of the devout Greeks, again, probably another way of referring to the God-fearers, the Gentiles who are already inclined toward the Old Testament scriptures and what they said, but they hadn't really become Jews as a proselyte. These devout Greeks are the ones that really respond well, because this is a message that says you Gentiles are welcome just like the Jews are. And so many of the devout Greeks, many of the leading Greek women respond, verse 5, but the Jews were jealous. And so what do? Well, they cause a big uproar. They cause a big rabble, it says here. They create a riot, basically, in the city. Again, this is very much like last week's passage. And they go and they're looking for Paul to bring him out. We're not sure what they would have done to him had they found him. But this mob, it says in verse 5, sets the city in an uproar. They attack the house of Jason, where Paul and his companions had been staying, wanting to bring him out, but they don't find him. And so instead they drag Jason out and some of the other brothers, other Christians that were there, and they take them to the city authorities, shouting, "These men who have turned the world upside down have come here also." So they're referring to the fact that Paul and his companions in other cities have been turning the world upside down, and now they've come to our city to do the same thing. We've got to stop them. Now, I mean, there's quite a bit of irony here, isn't there? Because it's like the people who are causing the riot, the people who are turning the town into an uproar, are accusing Paul and Silas of being the ones to, quote, turn the world upside down. This is what happened last week, too. And I'm not going to spend much time on that, because that was kind of last week's point, and I want to focus on something else here today. But just, you know, we see this throughout the book of Acts, and it shouldn't surprise us when we see it today. All right, we see that so much today, that the people that really stir everything up and cause a lot of problems blame other people who aren't doing that, as though they're the ones that did that. Verse 9, it says that they take money. This is sort of like bail or security that they take from Jason and his household. They let him go on bail, you could say, in verse 9. And after this, verse 10, the brothers immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea, a city several distance away. Would have taken several nights, probably, that Paul would have had to travel. But they're worried about his safety and his life, and so they send him away to another city. And what we see is that he comes to the city of Berea. We pick up in verse 10, the brothers immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea, and when they arrived, they went into the Jewish synagogue. Surprise, surprise. Now, these Jews were more noble than those in Thessalonica. Kind of draw a line back up to verse 5, the Jews in Thessalonica versus these Jews. And why? Why are they more noble? Well, these ones in Berea, it says, they received the word with all eagerness, examining the scriptures daily to see if these things were so. Many of them, therefore, believed, with not a few Greek women of high standing, as well as men. But when the Jews from Thessalonica heard that the word of God was proclaimed by Paul at Berea also, they came there too, agitating and stirring up the crowds, just continue to go out and cause problems and create controversy. Verse 14, then the brothers immediately sent Paul off on his way to the sea, but Silas and Timothy remained there to continue to build up and help teach and disciple these ones who were coming to understand these truths about Jesus as the Messiah, who had put their faith in Christ. Verse 15, those who conducted Paul brought him as far as Athens, and after receiving a command for Silas and Timothy to come to him as soon as possible, they too departed. Now in verse 11 here it says that these Jews were more noble than the ones in Thessalonica. And why? Why are they more noble? And it basically gives us two things, both related to the scriptures. It says, first off, they eagerly received the word. So they were eager to receive the things that Paul and Silas and Timothy and Luke and whoever were part of the teaching team there, that they were eager to receive these things. They had a heart that really wanted to hear what the scriptures said. And then secondly, they daily researched the word. They daily looked into these things. It says examining the scriptures daily to see if these things were so. They're going back to their Old Testament scriptures, and every day they're spending time studying them and researching them to see if, in fact, the things that Paul was teaching were, in fact, true. And the result is they discovered that, what do you know, it is true. We do see these things that we hadn't seen before. These things had kind of eluded our minds, but Christ has come, we see what Christ has said and taught, we go back in the scriptures, and sure enough, they did point to him. Sure enough, he is fulfilling a lot of things that were right here in our scriptures. And so many of them believed in verse 12. Again, if you want to draw a point of contrast up in verse 4 to the sum of the Jews in Thessalonica who believed. I already mentioned in verse 13 how these Jews who rejected what Paul had said from up in Thessalonica come to Berea, and they try to stir things up there and create controversy there as well. But here's the question I just want us to consider this morning and spend really the remainder of our time thinking about, and that is, are we, you as an individual, I as an individual, maybe even us as a church collectively, but specifically you as an individual and I as an individual, are we more like the Jews in Thessalonica or are we more like the Jews in Berea? We know which we're supposed to be more like. We know which one we're supposed to aspire toward. We know which one is the better example. It tells us very clearly. We know that we want to be Bereans. And so I just want to take some time to think about what are some ways possibly that we might be more like Thessalonians than Bereans when it comes down to some of those questions I opened the service up with. The truth is, both the Thessalonians and the Bereans, if you would have asked them, they would have said, we highly revere the scriptures. This wasn't an issue of theoretical values and priorities. Theoretically, at least, both groups would have said, we are Bible believers. The Old Testament scriptures are our point of authority. That is what we believe and that is what we trust. Both of them would, their worship, I assume, would have looked very similar. They both were in the practice of weekly coming to a synagogue to worship the same God from the same scriptures, and that's where they got their truth from. And so, in a sense, it's not like you have a starting point of secularists or atheists or pagans, and then over here you have the believers. You're starting with the same, outwardly at least, lump of people, the same sort of, they had the same look to them, and they would have affirmed the same things, more or less. But in practice, one group eagerly received the word, and they daily looked at it and researched it to see if things were so. And when they discovered what the word said, then they began to practice that. There's people, many of you have heard about the epidemic of the fentanyl crisis in our country. And it's been growing rapidly for the last few years. Fentanyl is a synthetic opioid It's up to 50 times stronger than heroin. It's extremely dangerous. I have a friend who's was until just recently a detective, narcotics detective, and I had asked him. I was like, well, you know, if this stuff is so strong and so dangerous, why does anybody even want it? Like, what would their point be? Because he does a lot of investigating into this, and he said, well, essentially, people whose bodies build up a tolerance to certain drugs, you know, they're addicted to a particular drug, but the more that they use that drug, the more of a tolerance their body builds up to it. It doesn't have the same results, and so they'll lace that drug with a little bit of fentanyl, and it produces a much stronger effect. The problem is, for those who don't have a tolerance built up to that sort of drug, when they try to use fentanyl, it can kill them because it's so powerful and so strong. This past year, in 2023, 300 people per day died from fentanyl overdoses, which was up from like 220 or something the year before. I don't know what 2024 will be, but it's continuing to go up and up. It's extremely dangerous. But you know what really makes fentanyl so much more dangerous is the fact that the drug cartels in Mexico, who are sending it to the States, they disguise it to look like other things. And so they will press this fentanyl into pills that look identical to other pharmaceuticals, ADHD drugs, anxiety medication, pain medication, and so on. And so you'll look at it, and it looks like a legitimate pharmaceutical drug. You can imagine how easy it would be for somebody on the streets, or just somebody who didn't realize it, would grab the wrong thing and immediately overdose. And even worse than that, and frankly more nefarious than that, is the fact that they oftentimes press these things to make them look like candy. And so, you know, there on the right, those are just, you know, colorful, what look like candy, and these are fentanyl pills. And so you might see some stories in the news of children in school who die from this, who assume that it's candy somehow, and they get it in. In fact, on the left in Massachusetts, back in I think it was December of last year, there was a huge drug bust. And if you can kind of tell, those are heart-shaped, pink-colored fentanyl pills that are made to look like Valentine's candy. Now here you have something that is an imitation. It's extremely dangerous, and it's made to look very much like something else. And I was just thinking, by way of illustration this morning, how oftentimes in conservative circles, we affirm our belief in the scripture, and that is the safety. That's what's safe. That is where we would find, you know, a foundation of truth. And yet there are other subtle things that look the same, or on the surface might feel the same, but they're quite different, and they're far more dangerous by way of philosophy. They are look-alike or imitations to Bereanism. And these things are usually things that people don't consciously and intentionally swallow. These are ideas that sort of subtly we sometimes even think we're just being biblical or founding ourselves in the Bible, and yet these other false substitutes can creep in. And so I wanted to consider just five examples of those this morning. The first one, and you might even be able to spread this across all of them in one sense, but the first is substituting me for the Bible. Substituting me for the Bible. This is where I just sort of assume that whatever I think is biblical. Now, people don't generally, like I said, do this on purpose. This isn't sort of an intentional sit down, you know what, I think whatever I believe must be right. That's not the point. This is sort of that subtle thing where anything that new comes along, the first and primary filter that we pass it through is, well, what does my gut say about this? How do I feel about this? What do I think? And then whatever our gut response is, then we more or less already have made up our mind, well, this must be wrong because I don't like the way this feels. Or this must be good because, and then we've got some sort of feely-feely reason internally why this seems good and right to me. And then if we do go to the Bible, it's sort of like, let me find some weak proof texts to confirm what I already have determined, I already think and believe. We've already made up our minds, more or less, based on some subtle gut feeling. This happens a lot. And I mean, it's not too hard to find some loose proof text taken out of a context to justify and verify the things that we think and feel. I mean, this is why you've got cults and you've got all different sorts of people. You even have secular people who you try to use the Bible to promote their wicked secular ideas and thoughts, because it's not hard to find a verse. Sometimes this dangerous false substitute is sort of the, well, I prayed about it and the Holy Spirit convinced me that that's what I'm supposed to do. Never mind that it contradicts pretty clear things that Scripture says are right. I prayed about it. Or sometimes it's just more of a generic, well, the Lord told me, or the Lord showed me. Or he confirmed in my spirit that. And I'm not trying to belittle the idea that sometimes there are things we pray about and we don't have a clear verse for it and the Holy Spirit leads us. I think he does lead that way, but that is never a substitute for following what the Scriptures say objectively. The Scriptures will lay out objective things for us, and the Holy Spirit is not going to lead us in a different way outside of what the Scriptures already say. The Proverbs just, you know, warn about this facet too. It says, and I could have about a dozen different Proverbs I could have pulled from, but just two of them, Proverbs 3, verse 7, be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. Similarly, in 21, verse 2, every way of a man is right in his own eyes, but the Lord weighs the heart. The principle that it's trying to get at is, look, you know, a wise person doesn't live by their own feelings. A wise person doesn't just live by what he thinks is right. Because everything we think is right. That's why we think it. I mean, I wouldn't have an opinion if I didn't think that opinion was right. And wisdom literature there in the Proverbs is saying, look, if you're going to be wise, you have to learn to second guess yourself. You have to learn to step back and say, just because I had a gut reaction to that, just because I have an opinion about that, just because that bothered me and annoyed me, doesn't mean it's wrong. Or just because I had this response where I felt like something was good doesn't actually mean that that's good. I need to take a step back and objectively look at this. And in the Proverbs here in particular, fearing God is the basis of wisdom. What does God say about this? What does God think about this? Every way of a man is right in his own eyes, but the Lord weighs the heart. I want God. I want to lay this before him and allow him to weigh this out. And so the substitution of me for Scripture is very subtle, and unfortunately, it's quite easy to slip into. A second one that I would say is this, substituting theological systems for the Bible. Substituting theological systems for the Bible. This one's really hard, and this one can be really subtle because people, you know, we all have theological systems, sort of systems, like if we were asked, well, what do you believe about this broad theological topic? Hopefully, the more that you've read or the more that you've studied Scripture or the more that you've been taught by others the Scriptures, you've got, you know, somewhat of a framework of a system of what is true and what is false. That's a good thing to have. I'm not undermining theological systems. Well, hopefully you have developed theological systems as you study the Scriptures. But the problem is this, is that what starts as a system that develops from our reading and studying of Scripture sometimes can take predominance over the Bible itself, to where we develop this system, and then every time we read the Scripture, we just read our system into the Scripture. And this system of thought sort of becomes the rubric or the grid by which we interpret everything, and we encounter passages of Scripture that sure seem to contradict something from this system, and then we just reinterpret those verses in a way that we are able to fit them neatly into our system. And essentially, we become more loyal to, a system, a theological system, than we do the Scripture itself. And that's where it becomes dangerous. Our systems, hopefully, are always something that we keep a little bit at arm's length. You know, we need those systems as logical people. It's just like a worldview. We have to have sort of a grid or a system by which we try to put together the different pieces of truth, things that we've come to believe are true, and we put them together and we systematize them because we're logical beings. But hopefully we're able to sort of keep our loyalty to the Scripture and hold loosely to our systems. But that's what I'm wanting to challenge you with. I remember several years ago, our kids were pretty young. It was probably 6 or 7 years ago. We took a trip to Baltimore, the Inner Harbor in Baltimore, because we were going to watch a Yankees-Orioles baseball game that evening. And we had spent quite a bit of time there at the Inner Harbor. It's kind of a really nice place if you've never been there. It's just kind of a neat place to visit. They've got a big mall, but it doesn't look like a mall. It's got like several stories. It's not a real big building, but it's like glass windows all across the front that look out toward the harbor. And anyways, we had kind of gone into there at one point. It was kind of hot outside, and we had been outside for much of the day. And we split up. I remember there was a bookstore, and I wandered into the bookstore, and I found myself pretty quickly in the religious books section, and I was just seeing what caught my eye. And there was a book there that caught my eye by somebody who was claiming to have had a near-death experience. And I had never really read up on near-death experiences. But my thought was very, very skeptical. It was like, yeah, I bet. Just my system, if you would, on that topic didn't really have much room for near-death experiences. There wasn't really anything in my history or what I had been taught or what I had thought about myself studying scripture that really had much room for that sort of a thing. And so I was highly skeptical, but I thought it'd be a fun read. So I picked it up, and I was kind of reading from the beginning. And it was a quite interesting story about how this guy had died, essentially. He felt his spirit leave his body, and he had gone, in his experience, to hell. And had spent time there, and then when he came back, that experience changed his life. He ended up getting saved and becoming a pastor. And I remember thinking to myself, you know, that his story had an element of truth to it, particularly because it didn't seem like his goal was to make a ton of money, or it seemed like he genuinely cared about people understanding the gospel. The gospel seemed to be predominant in the book, and so that sort of stuck with me, but I was still somewhat skeptical. And over the next year or so, really, I kind of found myself exploring this whole idea of what do I really think about near-death experiences, and trying to wrestle with, is this possible? Is this a biblical thing? Is this a made-up thing? Are these satanic experiences? And, you know, just in a nutshell, it's like I was kind of surprised at some things I hadn't thought about before. But number one, the main thing was that Paul seems to have had one of those experiences, where Paul talks about possibly leaving his body. He says, you know, I went to the third heaven. In the body or out of the body, I don't know. In other words, it seems like it felt like an out-of-body experience to him, but whether that was just how it felt and it was really more like a vision, who knows, but he went to heaven, and then he came back. And it doesn't even seem like it was primarily about his ability to tell people about it, because he says most of the things he saw, he wasn't permitted to talk about. And so at least for him, that was a personal experience that he had. And then I thought about the Apostle John, who wrote Revelation, and much of Revelation was written as John had similar experiences, including visions, or maybe out of body, it doesn't say, but visions at least of heaven, and was through a vision able to go and see and experience some of that. In Acts, in chapter 2, at Pentecost, The Old Testament prophecy is quoted, and it said that is being fulfilled, that lots of normal common people will have visions and dream dreams. And so there will be some supernatural things happening that God will use to bring people to him. And I thought to myself, you know, I don't see anything in the scriptures that would seem to forbid it. In fact, it would seem like that at least those examples would allow for that. And so it's just an example of something where my gut reaction to something was skepticism, and this is corny, and this is flaky. But at least I believe when I stepped back and thought about it and took some time to think through from a biblical perspective, I actually think it's probably legit. I'm actually quite open to that. And so I would just encourage all of us to, again, is the Bible the standard by which we're going to judge experiences and truth claims, or is it just our initial gut reaction and response? But then thirdly, another imitation of Bereanism would be substituting a church or a denomination for the Bible. You know, for many, it's very easy to more or less just assume that whatever denomination I'm in or whatever church I'm in, that I'm just going to trust them. And we kind of look at, and we're well aware that other churches or other denominations practice some things differently, teach some things differently, and as we process them versus us, it's just easy to assume they're wrong, I'm right, or we're right and they're wrong. Of course, we've seen even just recently denominations having major splits over significant issues as the denomination that previously held to a more orthodox view rethinks it and decides to go in a different direction, and we see the result of that, a massive split in some denominations over rethinking and redeciding where they stand on things. Truth is, God calls all of us to be good, active students of the Word. 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. We are to be hard workers. You know, it's easy to be lazy. It's easy to be lazy theologically, to sit back and just go with the flow of whatever church I'm in, whatever denomination I'm in, and just assume that they're getting it right. Whatever one I grew up in, maybe, whatever one my parents were, whatever the factor is that led us into that, to just sort of sit back and be lazy. But we're called to be hard workers, to be those that rightly handle the word of truth. And Jesus said in Luke chapter 12 and verse 48, that everyone to whom much was given, of him much will be required. And from him whom they entrusted much, they will demand the more. I think it's a broader principle that says to those who have access to more things, those who have more opportunities, God is going to hold them to a higher standard. He's going to require more of them. And my goodness, here in America, the opportunities we have to be good Bereans, to search out the scriptures. We have access to how many different versions and translations that we can go and read and compare against others. We've got commentaries and online commentaries and speakers and preachers and teachers online, and so many ways that we can spend time researching the scriptures and doing our best to work hard to try to understand, what does God want? What does he say in his word? A fourth one, and this relates to the third one, but I want to look at it a little differently, and that is substituting traditions for the Bible. Substituting traditions for the Bible. Now, I know denominations and churches have their own traditions and ways of doing things, and so in that sense, maybe there's some overlap. But I'm thinking more of the tendency to idolize, or idealize is probably a better word, to idealize some certain period of time in the past as sort of, that's when church was done the right way. And how do we get back to that? Sort of the nostalgia of, and it's probably whatever period of time I grew up in as a child, in my mind it's like, well, that was when they were doing it right, and everything new is just a perversion, is just changing something for the worse. And there's sort of this idealizing a certain period of time and the traditions associated with that time. And it's easy sometimes for us to fall into the judging everything new by the standard of, well, how does it relate back to this tradition? And whatever it deviates from that tradition, then it's worse. I think you all understand what I'm referencing here. And the interesting thing is in Acts chapter 17, Paul and Silas were bringing something new to Thessalonica and Berea. What they were bringing in was going to require a lot of change in how the Jews in those synagogues understood worship and how they understood their relationship to God and their relationship to Gentiles and their relationship to the Mosaic law. And it was going to reprioritize things and change things. And this seems to be what led to the jealousy in the Thessalonians. They didn't really want to search the scriptures out. They just had a gut feel that they didn't like this. It was going to affect them. They were comfortable how they were doing it. That's what they knew and were used to. And they were jealous of this idea of all of these formerly outsiders now being brought in. But the Bereans, who I am sure had some of those same, you know, tension, they were feeling a lot of that same tension, I have to imagine, as Jews, trying to wrestle with all of this new stuff that Paul is teaching. But he says they were so much more noble because they take a step back and say, well, let's just look at these scriptures and see if this is so. And if it is, we want to accept it. There's one final substitute that I want to point out, and that is substituting a respected teacher for the Bible. The tendency sometimes to substitute a pastor or a theologian or a guy who authors or even a woman who authors various books and just sort of becoming a devotee of that person rather than a student of Scripture. Now, obviously, this isn't against preachers and teachers. The Bible says God gives churches gifted people in areas of teaching and preaching and leadership for good reason. And here, Paul and Silas are in their midst teaching them and expounding from things from the Scriptures. He reasoned in verse 2 for 3 days from the Scriptures. Verse 3, explaining and proving his points about the Messiah. And we sense he does the same thing in Berea. But Paul doesn't then commend the Bereans and say, I'm so glad that you just trusted me. I'm so glad that you didn't question me and feel the need to go back and make sure that what I was saying was true. Thank you for respecting me enough to just trust me. That's not what he says, is it? He doesn't commend them for trusting him. He commends them for being students of the word. In fact, at some level, they were at least somewhat skeptical, and he commends them for that. Thank you for going back and searching the Scriptures. Paul seems to recognize that he isn't infallible. The issue wasn't, well, I'm inspired, so listen to me. No, it's the Scriptures are inspired. Study them. I was invited to write a really short blog post several years ago, 4 or 5 years ago, on a topic related to the study of Scripture. And basically, it was just about how, regardless of a person's education level, what are some simple things they can do when reading the Scriptures to identify pretty quickly what the main theme is and what the main thing that the author was trying to say. And so that was sort of the gist of the article that I wrote. And one of the few people who interacted in the comments section, because it was put online, and one of the few people that interacted with it said something like, it's no longer online, I couldn't find this, I wanted to go and just see what the actual comment was, but as I remembered, it was something along the lines of, well, I don't think average people should be trying to read and interpret the Bible for themselves. I think the safest thing to do is to find a good educated preacher, teacher who does it well and follow them. It's essentially the gist of it. And for him, he specifically said for him it was John MacArthur. John MacArthur's the guy I listen to, I read what he has to say. Nobody out there is going to do it better than him, and I think that's way safer. And I tried interacting with him a little bit. You know, you're trying to be polite and kind, and he just wouldn't budge. And it's like there's an obvious flaw to his thinking. You know, why John MacArthur and not Bill Hybels or some other well-known guy? Like, who's deciding that? You are. Like, you have figured something out about this guy's teaching that has caused you to say he's the one. So you are making decisions about interpretation, whether you acknowledge it or not. But, you know, most of us aren't that obvious about it, but aren't we susceptible to that too, where we get a favorite teacher or a favorite author, and especially when it comes to more difficult topics, we just sort of go with them, whatever they say. And we sort of circumvent the hard work of studying this for myself, particularly studying those hard things through the lens of, I want to hear what other people have to say about it too. In fact, I want to hear what people on the other side of this argument have to say, and if there's three or four sides, I kind of want to study it all, and I want to ultimately anchor what I think is the most biblical. You know, we live in a time where there's lots of cultural change. Some of it's good. Technological advancements, advancements in medicine, people are able to live longer. Some of it's evil. A growing acceptance of sin, higher rates, significantly higher rates of depression and anxiety. Some of the change in our world provides new ministry opportunities of people from all over the world coming here and opportunities to engage in different ways with people who have very different cultural backgrounds and traditions and such. Churches are in the process, they have been for decades now, of changing and adapting and confronting and addressing these shifts in various ways. And, you know, how should God's people respond to those changes and shifts and adjustments? Certainly we want to respond with wisdom and discernment, but what does that look like? Does it go with your gut? Is it use your theological systems to be a grid and anything that falls outside of it, cut it away and just stick to that system? Is it follow my church and its denomination and it won't lead me astray? Is it look to the past and always try to hearken back to something back there? Is it find a trusted teacher or preacher and follow them? No. We're called to be Bereans, to anchor ourselves in God's word, and as best that we can to allow this to develop the right beliefs and thoughts and understandings. I'm going to invite the praise team to come. I'm going to pray this morning. We also have the opportunity to celebrate the work of Jesus Christ in our salvation through communion. And so as the praise team comes, begin to adjust your heart and your thoughts to the work of Christ on the cross. Father, we're so thankful and grateful for the words that you give us. We live in a time where we have your word, Old and New Testament, in a language that we understand and can read. And Lord, help us to use that, to study it, to be students of it. We want to be approved by you. We don't want to be led astray by things that look good or seem like they are safe, but in reality they're something other than the foundation of your word which you've given us. In Jesus' name we pray now. Amen.
We're going to sing a couple of worship songs as we prepare for communion, and you can just remain seated. Just a little note, verses 1 and 2 will not have a chorus between them. But I know
King above all kings.
Paul was in Thessalonica teaching them. The primary thing that he was teaching them about was how Jesus had come in fulfillment of the scriptures. It says he went, verse 3, explaining and proving that it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and then to rise from the dead, and saying, "This Jesus whom I proclaim to you is the Christ." And that's what we get to proclaim here. In fact, Jesus said that whenever you eat, or Paul said, whenever you eat and drink of this cup, you are proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes. And we have an opportunity to essentially affirm ourselves amongst those who, in both of those churches, believed. They heard the message and they believed. And one of the ways that we just remind ourselves, we remind ourselves on occasions, on a regular basis, that this is what I believe. It's a reaffirmation of the simple truth that I believe that Jesus did come in fulfillment of those Old Testament scriptures, that when he died on that cross and he gave his body up and he allowed his blood to be shed for us, that he was in fact the Christ. He was and is the Messiah, and he is the one that our identity is wrapped around, that we are identified with him, and that is the basis of our salvation. It's not because we keep enough of the rules. It's not because we're good enough people. It's not even because we've gone through certain ceremonies and that sort of initiates us into salvation. It's faith in Jesus Christ. And so this practice is essentially for those who are believers in Jesus, that we do this as an act of remembering, conscious remembering of what Jesus did for us, and that our faith is in him. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 11, he says, "For I have received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let's do that now in remembrance of him. In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's partake together of the cup. Thank you, Lord, for saving our souls. Thank you for taking upon yourself the wrath of the Father, directed at us, the sins that we had committed, and you took that on yourself. You shielded us from that wrath. And we just partake together today, Lord, in remembrance of you and what you've done. And Father, we do this in with thankful hearts, and worship toward you. Only a great and all-wise God could come up with this wonderful solution to the sin problem. Be with us now as we leave. Lord, may we even throughout this week remember that our identity is anchored and rooted in Jesus. That it's because of what he did that we desire to love and serve him even this week, at work, at home, with our families, outside, when our neighbors are around. Help us to be an example and a light and a testimony of who you are and what you've done through us. And may your image shine through us, I pray. In Jesus' name.